how do we take code which is written in a high level language and convert that into another target? Typically what happens is we are usually interested in converting from something in a high level language to something else which is at a lower level, right? And the definitions of high and low are somewhat subjective, but usually it is clear from the context. The main steps involved are lexical analysis and parsing, which would just be basically reading the program in the high level language and breaking it up into the appropriate tokens, right? In the process, you convert into something called an intermediate representation. And it is on the intermediate representation that most of the optimization is done, right? So all the steps involved in optimization, the modifications to the program structure, so to say, are done at the intermediate representation level. So what are the kinds of optimizations that we would normally look at? If you were talking about software, it would be the size of the resulting code and the execution time, how fast does it run? In terms of hardware, it would typically be how many gates result from the compilation that you have done, and also possibly the critical path, that is, what is the clock frequency at which the system can work? Okay. Typically, this is done by some kind of manipulation of graphs, because the intermediate representation usually lends itself to some kind of graph-like representation, right? Because ultimately, what you're trying to do is capture all the dependencies that are there. The whole purpose of studying these optimizations is that as far as possible, we should be able to automate the processes involved, right? So one thing that you need to keep in mind, because next we will be moving into a series of optimizations that can actually be applied on systems, right? And what you need to keep in mind when we are sort of studying this is that although you might then be tempted to look at your code and say, okay, can I apply this kind of optimization? Should I rewrite my code in this way and so on? For the most part, the purpose of these optimizations is to say that don't worry too much about it, right? You should not be trying and doing too many of those optimizations by hand, right? What is the reason for that? There are two reasons. One is these are optimizations that compilers can do fairly effectively on their own, right? So as long as you have written your code in a relatively clean manner, it is easy for the compiler to sort of observe patterns and replace them with the more optimized versions of the patterns, right? The more important reason why it is not always recommended that you do this on your own is that it makes your code unreadable. It makes your code hard to understand. Okay, so once again, you know, I'll skip over this part. The general guidelines, like I said, mostly common sense, right? Optimize the common case, avoid redundancy, less code is better, and so on, right? We will look at exceptions to some of these. Things like memory awareness are actually target dependent, right? They depend on the properties of the target hardware or architecture that you are optimizing for, right? And finally, the trace guided optimization, profiling based, is always an important thing to keep in mind, because ultimately the best way to understand where the bottlenecks are in your code is to actually run it and see which functions or which parts of the code are called the maximum number of times or are ending up running the slowest. Okay, sometimes that you can predict that ahead of time, right, at the compilation time itself. But very often what happens is you get that information only after you have actually tried running it on some test cases, right? And that's basically what we mean by create a trace, right? Run it on a test case, find out how it performs, and then you realize that, okay, these are the things that need to be optimized. One general warning is beware premature optimization. And what I mean by premature optimization is related to what I said earlier. Do not be tempted to go and rewrite your code such that, you know, you apply all the optimizations that we discuss over here, right? And the reason I say that is because very often you might find that by doing some of those minor optimizations, you have now changed your code in such a way that some of the major system level optimizations are now no longer possible, okay? And that is a trap that a lot of people fall into, right? I mean, the moment you know that there are certain kinds of optimizations that can be done, it seems exciting to go and modify your code such that, you know, all these optimizations are taken care of. As a designer, you should usually be looking at one level higher than that. These are optimizations that a compiler can do, can you do something else that a compiler could not have observed or could not have understood, because it simply has no understanding of the code that you are writing, right? So how can you, with your higher level understanding of what needs to be done or what is the problem to be solved, what are the kinds of changes that you can make to your code? That is the part that you usually as a designer should be focusing on. So coming to the list of, you know, optimizations, right? I'm just basically going to go through a number of different examples over here, right? The first and sort of most basic one is something called constant folding and constant propagation. Okay. And the purpose of this is, you know, sometimes when you write code, you would actually have something which says, you know, inside a function, you might have a couple of lines of code like this: x is equal to 3 plus 5, y is equal to x plus 4, etc. Right. So if you look at this code, there are two ways that you can run this, right? The x is equal to 3 plus 5. When you generate the output code, the assembly language code, you could actually have code which basically says, load the value 3 into one register, load the value 5 into another register, and put in the operation add R1 plus R2 and put the result in R1. Okay. That is x is equal to 3 plus 5. Okay. Another way of doing it would be to say 3 plus 5, it's always a constant, right? It doesn't matter whether you do it at compilation time or at runtime. Why don't I just replace it with the value x is equal to 8? Okay. So this x is equal to 3 plus 5 can be folded, meaning that this constant can be evaluated at compile time. Right. Now, why is that a good thing? Because it means that at runtime, the assembly language instruction just reduces to one step. Load the value 8 into a register, rather than having load 3 into a register, load 5 into a register, and then add the two registers together, right? So that x is equal to 3 plus 5 can be reduced to just one instruction, which basically says load the value 8 into a register. Okay. But now you can go one step further and say, why don't I also propagate that value? I know at compile time that x has the value 8. Okay. Based on that, what can I say about the value of y? This can also be evaluated at compile time. I do not need an instruction that actually does an addition at runtime in order to find that y is equal to 12. Right? So I just replace this with y equal to 12. Okay. Now, of course, why do I even need x and y? Presumably, x and y are being used somewhere else in the code further down. Okay. If they are not, then there was no purpose to even doing this optimization. On the other hand, as far as the compiler is concerned, right, the thing that you need to keep in mind is the compiler is literally looking at the code one line at a time. Okay. It is not sort of jumping ahead and saying, you know, how do I optimize all of this at, how do I understand what the code is trying to do and do high level optimizations. Instead, it's looking one line at a time, in which case x is equal to 3 plus 5, you can easily replace. Y equal to x plus 4. Now that you know the value of x, you can put that value of x in, right? That's the constant propagation part. And once again, replace it with a constant at compile time. Okay. What are the purpose of these optimizations? They are basically reducing the amount of code that you have in your system at the actual runtime. So it will usually result in a smaller code, right? Smaller program. The assumption we are making is that all of these kind of optimizations make sense when you need to compile once, but then you will run the program many times. Okay. So let's say that you are writing an operating system, or for that matter, you are creating a browser, right? Or for you know, something of that sort, right? Some kind of a program where your compilation process, you are willing to let it run for a long time. In fact, hardware is an extreme case of this. Right? As far as hardware is concerned, you are going to compile once, then you are going to actually fabricate the chip or program the FPGA, and that chip or FPGA will then run several times. I mean, either it will be, either you will create several thousands of copies of that chip, or at least the chip, every time that it is switched on, will operate, will run the same way. The next step that we can go a bit further with this, right, is something called common sub expressions. Okay. Now, the line of code that I've written over here is something which, you know, if any of you are writing a code corresponding to, let's say, a communication system, this is entirely possible, right? I mean, this is pretty much how you would do the IQ modulation, right? So XI over here would correspond to some set of values, which are basically the I component of some signal, right? The real valued component of a signal. And XQ would probably be something like the imaginary component, right? What you are actually trying to do is some Z e power omega t, okay? That's basically what you are trying to emulate by means of a equivalent digital signal, which means it has been converted into discrete time, right? So that's why I have these samples in I. But ultimately, if you look at it, what you find is that, you know, there is this thing out here, 2 into pi into fc, right? So the first thing that you can notice over here is 2 into pi is definitely a constant. Okay, so at compile time, I can certainly replace 2 into pi with one value. Okay, now the thing is, what else can I do over here? This fc is usually some kind of a carrier frequency, right? Which might be something which is obtained only at runtime, right? Or rather is something that you want to program at runtime, right? Maybe you want to do some kind of a modulation. So you actually want to change the center frequency of the modulation, which means that the compiler cannot do anything about it. Okay, so the 2 into pi could be replaced with one constant, but the into fc cannot be replaced with a constant. But if you look at it, you find that the 2 into pi into fc is used multiple times. Right? In fact, what you'll find is this entire 2 into pi into fc into I, right? This entire thing over here is used twice, right? Within the same expression. So what I can do is basically call this entire thing as a sub-expression. Why do I call it a sub-expression? Because obviously this, you know, what I have over here is this entire y of I is one mathematical expression. Within that, there are certain sub-parts which it turns out are actually computed twice. Okay, now how would I do this? I could probably more effectively rewrite this as inside this for loop, right? I would introduce one new variable. Let's say t is equal to 2 into pi into fc into I, right? I can do this entire computation once. And then I can basically say y of I equals xi of I into cos of t plus xq of I into sine of t. Okay. So because I computed t once, I'm able to reuse it in two places. Okay. So this is essentially what we call the common sub-expression. Common in the sense that not that it is something which happens often, right? More that it is common to multiple sub-expressions within the computation. Now, a concept called dead code elimination, right? And dead code is essentially defined as something which will never be executed, okay? So if you look through this code, right, this function int f of int f with all of these statements written over here, right, let's straight away jump ahead and look at this last statement, return j, right? And the question I'm asking is, can this ever get executed? Okay, and at least as long as I'm working with regular C semantics, the answer is no, I can never hit this, because the previous return I was not based on a if statement. There was no condition over there. It just says return I. Okay, which means that in practice, when I'm running through this function, I will never actually hit return j. Okay, so this is a dead line of code. This can never be called, basically, right? Which means that I can go one step further back and say, what about the j equal to 2? This was also a dead line of code, right? For the same reason, because I assign j equal to 2 and return j, but if I'm never going to return j, then why should I bother to do the assignment even, right? Because usually assignment means loading a value into a register. Okay, let's look further over there, right? I have, for example, this I equal to 1, but if I look further down, I find that over here I'm doing I equal to 3, and I never used I equal to 1 anywhere in between. Therefore, I can say that this I equal to 1 is also dead code. Okay? Anything further that you can look at? Right? The j equal to 2, is it ever getting used inside this function? At least no, because I have this j equal to 2, which is promptly overwritten by j equal to I plus 4. But even the j equal to I plus 4 is actually irrelevant, right? None of these lines actually affect the output that is generated. Right? In fact, this entire function could probably have just been translated into just int f. What would it be? It would just say return 3. Okay, I don't need to declare I, I don't need to declare j, I don't need to do anything else. I can just say return 3 and be done. Okay, now obviously the question that would come up is, why would I ever write code like this? And of course the answer is, you would never write code like this, right? Hopefully not, at least, right? But then why should we even think about something of this sort? Think about the kinds of optimizations that we were talking about earlier, right? Some kinds of constant propagations, some kind of other sub-expression eliminations. As a result of doing some of those optimizations, you might find a situation where some of your subsequent lines of code become redundant. Okay, so dead code is usually something that a compiler finds as a result of some other optimizations that it has done, right? And by eliminating all the dead code, you not only bring down the size of the code, you potentially also have this thing that, you know, you could reduce you almost certainly will also reduce the number of cycles that it takes to execute, right? Because you are not doing anything redundant or irrelevant. Code hoisting. Okay, now code hoisting essentially is saying that this is related to the example that we saw earlier with the 2 into pi into fc into I, right? In this case, I mean, let's start with this simple example. I'm just basically doing y of I equal to a plus b, right? So it looks as though I will need to do this addition 100 times, right? Is that really relevant? No, because I could have basically taken this t equal to a plus b and put it outside the loop, right? So I could have written this as t is equal to a plus b, and then for I is equal to 0 to 100, y of I equals t. Okay, I still need to do this because I need to initialize the y array, right? So the for loop is still required. I can't avoid that. All that we are saying is, you don't need to do the addition inside the for loop. Now, strength reduction. Okay, this essentially what it says is, are there better ways to perform certain kinds of computations? Okay, now what do I mean by a better way? Multiplication, right? Usually, I mean, in modern x86 processors and so on, there will always be one hardware multiplier present. And in fact, usually that is optimized to the point where it can do arbitrary, you know, 32 cross 32 or sometimes even 64 cross 64 multiplications within a single clock cycle. Okay. But on the other hand, especially for microcontrollers or even in the case of hardware, right, putting a multiplier in there, right, will actually be quite expensive. In which case, what we could actually say is, you know, why would I do y is equal to and x is equal to y into 4? Right? Can I do this in a better way? I could basically have written this as y left shift by 2. Okay. Now, whether I am implementing pure hardware or let's say that I'm doing this inside a microcontroller, I will usually find that y left shifted by 2 is more efficient than y multiplied by 4. Because y multiplied by 4 needs me to actually use the multiplication unit, whereas y left shift by 2 in hardware is actually free, right? It's just basically a wiring problem, right? You just need to sort of realign the bits that you are using, right? Similarly, t by 8, assuming that I'm doing only integer division, would be t right shift by 3. Okay, once again, no multiplication or division involved. Division is even more expensive than multiplication, right? So this is what we are saying. We are basically talking about the strength of certain operations. Operations that are hard to implement or take time can now be replaced by something simpler. Okay. Now, what about the third case, q into 15, right? Now it's no longer just one left shift, right? But what I can do is that I can still rewrite this as q into 16 minus 1, right? Which is basically equal to q left shift by 4 minus q. Okay, so once again I have eliminated the multiplication operation, or rather I have replaced it with an addition or a subtraction, in this case a shift and a subtraction. Okay, is this actually better off, right? May or may not be, because in practice what you might find is that, especially on a processor like the x86, the multiplication is just one instruction, it finishes in one clock cycle, whereas left shift by 4 will be one instruction, right? And subtraction will be another instruction. So you might actually end up making things worse. Okay, so this strength reduction is an example where you have to be careful. You have to know what architecture you are targeting. If it is hardware, then this q left shift by 4 minus q is definitely going to be better than putting in a hardware multiplier which can multiply by 15, right? On the other hand, if it's x86 which has a hardware multiplier, then you might find that just, you know, using the multiplication operation is better. Okay, function inlining, right, essentially says that, let's say I have a function f which has a very simple kind of computation. It's basically doing x square, right? So it basically returns x into x. Okay, and then function g uses function f internally. What can I do with this? I could just as well have replaced it by a single int g, which just basically does return x into x plus y into y. Okay, so basically what I've done is I have inlined the function f. Now why is this relevant? Because if you look at how a function gets called in software, right, I'm still talking about software over here, a function call would basically involve saving the present state of g, right, putting the variable x onto the stack for a new function, right, saving the stack pointer, etc., etc., and then jumping to the location for f, okay, at least some 3 or 4 clock cycles. After that I perform one instruction. Now x into x is just basically one multiply operation, and then I have return. What do I do on return? I need to pop the stack pointer, I need to get back to the place where I came from, I need to restore the variables that were saved as a result of doing this, right? Lots of work for something which was actually very trivial. The problem with function inlining, right, is that potentially it can result in larger code than you started with. And the reason I say that is, let's say that, I mean, I, over here I've given you an example where g calls f twice, right? But let's say that g called f, you know, 10 times, and more importantly that f itself was a little bit more than just one line of code. Okay, f was maybe 2 or 3 lines. Okay, now suddenly what happens is, in g every time that f is called it has to be replaced with 3 lines of code, and there are 10 such occurrences. You suddenly have 30 lines of code where previously it was just, you know, 10 function calls. Okay, so in such a situation the code size might increase. Can it still result in a decrease in running time? Possibly, because, you know, it might turn out that even those 3 lines of code are things that can are more efficient than having the function call overhead. Okay, so function inlining can potentially result in an increase in the code size. So now, after all of those optimizations, it takes us to the next class of optimization, so to say, which are to do with loops. Okay, and loops are a very big chunk of what we try to do in terms of overall optimizations, okay, in any kind of code. In the context of software, typically what we would do would be that we, you know, initialize a counter, we either increment or decrement, depending on, you know, it's a for loop, for I is equal to 0, I less than 100, I plus plus, increment, right? If it was I minus minus, decrement, and so on. But every time that you are going through this, you also need to test the condition, and then there is a branch involved, right? Either you need to branch back to the beginning of the loop or continue. Okay, so So there is usually some penalty involved with branching, because especially for a pipelined processor, right, usually what would happen is by the time you get the branch, you have decoded it, you have figured out whether it needs to be executed or not, some three clock cycles have passed, three or more clock cycles have passed, right? What should you do during that time, right? Should you be continuing execution of new operator, new instructions, or should you abandon it and say, you know, I'll just wait until I don't know whether the branch is taken or not. In turn, that has given reason to a lot of optimizations at the hardware level in terms of something called branch prediction, okay, which basically tries to say, given a certain type of code, can I intelligently, or rather, you know, based on some history or something else, can I predict whether or not the branch would be taken and decide accordingly whether to, you know, continue with my code or whether to jump back and do something else. Okay. So in the software level, those are the kinds of overheads that are involved when you're implementing loops. On the hardware level, on the other hand, how are loops implemented? They are typically going to be some kind of a finite state machine plus a counter, right? Once again, the same story, right? The finite state machine needs to check some condition. There will be some multiplexing which decides whether I need to jump back to the state or whether I need to proceed. And similarly, there will be some multiplexing which decides, you know, what inputs should be given to the computational units, okay? And on top of that, if there is some read or write operation involved over there from memory, that in turn would add extra latency, right? Bottom line is, whether you are working with software or hardware, there are definitely overheads associated with loops.